agree on. The second part of the firm is Crescent Financial Advisors. Crescent Financial Advisors is a business development arm of Crescent Financial Partners. And just to back up a little bit, Crescent Financial Partners is a principal investor. The specialty is, or the niche is about $2 to $10 million per project, early stage. And then we use the advisory business to do the business development, whether it be developing business plans, putting together funding documents, valuations, very, very deep diligence on particular companies or sectors. The key areas that we're interested in are software, information technology, internet services, e-commerce, clean and renewable energy, consumer products, healthcare and entertainment. We're different than many firms in the sense that we're very general in our approach. We really pride ourselves on not specializing in any particular field. Instead, we look for emerging opportunities, emerging markets, and with a goal to get in early and get out early. And that's basically what I've done for 23 years professionally, so it's what I know. As far as the process at Crescent Financial Advisors, we look at about 100 companies a month. Of those 100, we will narrow it down to about 20 to do what I call deep diligence on. Of the 20, we will perform biz dev services for about 10, and of those 10, we will invest in 1 to 2. Why Brazil? Basically, it's the eighth largest economy in the world, as you were told earlier. 2010 GDP, $2.2 trillion. Growth rate last year of 7.5%, which is pretty staggering. 2009 was 5%, so they're obviously recovering from the downturn very, very nicely. 2010 exports, $242 billion. And direct investment, $65 billion last year. They've already reached $60 billion this year. And that will probably come in at about $120 billion by year end. So I think the secret's out, and a lot of money is now being deployed in Brazil. Primary markets there, obviously, are agriculture. GDP accounts for $400 billion in agriculture, with about $150 billion of that being exported. Therefore, they're the number one global exporter in coffee, beef, poultry, sugar, and orange juice. As far as energy goes, they're the world leader in renewable energy resources. They're the third largest producer of hydroelectricity. Petrobras is the fourth largest oil company in the world. And with their recent Tupa find, they, within the next 3 years, stand to be the 10th largest exporter of oil in the world. So these two discoveries are probably the biggest in the last 20 years. Why Brazil? It's the eighth largest economy, the world's eighth largest IT market, investment grade, Fitch and S&P, political and economic stability. Had very strong ties with the United States for a number of years. So very, very strong relationship there. Cultural compatibility, and this is probably the most important for me because I've literally tried to do business in many countries around the world, and some of the most obvious, as far as I'm concerned, have been some of the more difficult, such as Australia, where on the surface it looks like a pure capitalist society, but in reality it's very much socialism, and you know, you're always competing with the government no matter what you do down there. Brazil, you know, I can truly say that in my visits there and in my diligence and my dealings in Brazil, it's very similar to Los Angeles. I mean, I feel very much at home. It's a beautiful place to do business. So you haven't been, I would encourage you to take a trip to Brazil. World-class infrastructure, a very skilled labor force. These four categories here were something I found in the economic index, the Economist Index. The four key areas that Brazil ranks very high on, and that's the political stability, property rights, the financial system, and the IT infrastructure. They literally rank as high as any of the BRIC nations in these four categories. The current landscape in Brazil is very interesting, especially as far as I'm concerned. As you see by this chart, there's a lot of money being deployed in the public sector. Private equity is substantially lower, but it's still significant. And as you'll see, venture capital in 2009 for early stage businesses was virtually non-existent. So now if you fast forward to 2010, as you see, private equity 41%, venture capital 31%, and all of a sudden seed capital and startup is accounting for 15%. So that's a staggering increase in just 1 year. The number of investments by sectors, as you'll see, the four key sectors have been the ag business, pharmaceutical, medical, energy and oil, IT and electronics. The difference is, and you know, you would see a very similar chart in the United States, every one of these categories has emerging opportunities. Communications, maybe food and beverage is a little mature in the United States. In a country like Brazil, there's vast opportunities of high growth type businesses. So even though there's a concentration in these four, you're going to find a lot of rising stars in these other categories over the next 5 to 10 years. Where is Crescent actively currently? Infrastructure, education, civil construction and real estate, pharmaceutical, energy and oil, and IT and electronics. How did investing in Brazil come onto our radar? I have a friend in Los Angeles, and probably 3 years ago, he was telling me about a company that he co-founded in Brazil called GVT back in 2000. They basically bought a very small telecom company. It was part of the deregulation. When they bought the company, it was primarily analog based, and they saw the opportunity to convert it to digital. Well, hence, 6 years later, took the company public for $4.5 billion. So, you know, these opportunities are very ripe in an economy that's growing as fast as Brazil. And that's really what garnered my attention and why I started looking at Brazil. The current companies that we're involved in, PDSoft is infrastructure, inventory and management software product. One of the biggest assets in the United States is our infrastructure, bridges, roads, oil and gas pipelines, and you would be alarmed to know that the federal government doesn't necessarily know when a bridge was last maintenance or when is the next maintenance required. And we have trillions of dollars of infrastructure in this country. So this is a company that has developed a very robust inventory management and maintenance software system. They're currently seeking $5 million in a first round, which we're going to participate in. And we're very excited not only to deploy the software in Brazil, but also possibly bring the software to the United States. The second is Inglis C. Barreras. It was a very, very successful English teaching course here in the United States with two of the bigger events in the world about to take place in Brazil. There's a desperate need to teach the working class population how to communicate in English. And I'm talking about hotel personnel, waiters, taxi drivers, and that's exactly what this particular curriculum focuses on. We think over the next 5 years, this product alone could possibly generate upwards of a couple of $100 million in revenue. We're currently completing a $2 million round for the company. Pharmaceutical, we have partnered with Amazona Via. It's a unique all natural cosmetics company using special natural ingredients from the Amazon forest. Brazil currently manufactures some of the finest skincare and beauty care products in the world. They're largely consumed in the country of Brazil. We have partnered with this company. We own a company in the United States called BeautyTicket.com. It's basically a branded beauty tickets online liquidator, and we've partnered to bring this product to the United States and liquidate it through BeautyTicket.com. We've made a $1 million investment to date, and we're looking to make another $5 million investment. Genea Energy. This is a company that we got involved with in late 2009. Basically, we're retained to do business development for the company, put their business plan together, put their funding documents together, and right as we were going out to the capital markets, about a week before, they made the cover of Forbes magazine as one of the top 20 most promising companies in America. So, needless to say, it was a very easy financing. But what this company does is it brings efficiency to commercial real estate. It actually is smart software that reduces energy consumption by 15%. So here's an opportunity to take a U.S.-developed software to Brazil. They have a tremendous commercial real estate market down there, largely void any technology or energy efficiency IP. So this is a company that we're actually in the process of licensing the software to take to Brazil. Comprepar is basically, there's an enormous push by the Brazilian government right now to attract foreign venture capital money into Brazil. They offer guarantee programs. I can go to Brazil, partner with a local citizen, and basically invest up to $10 million, and the government will guarantee the principal investment on that money as long as you follow a certain criteria in deploying that money. We've committed our first investment of $2 million, and we're looking to increase that. The first fund will finance up to 10 new early stage businesses. This is a company that I'll let Robert get into in more detail. It's part of his presentation. It's a company we're very excited about. Healthcare, E-Prime Care is basically a software to manage healthcare plans and make them more efficient. Probably no one in this room knows exactly what their healthcare plan says, or at the end of the day, what services they're entitled to or not entitled to. And there's a great deal of inefficiency in that entire process. And as we get older, it's one of the more important things in our lives. So, knowing more about this aspect is very important, and will only become more so as the aging population gets older. What are we learning about Brazil? About 15 years ago, I had an opportunity to go to China and do business, and I looked for every reason not to. It geographically wasn't real easy to get to. There were cultural differences, language differences. I live in LA. I mean, there's more business in my backyard than I could do in a lifetime. And so, in hindsight, I looked for every reason in the world to forego one of the biggest opportunities in my lifetime. And so today I sit here and I look at Brazil, and I feel like the same opportunity exists in Brazil. So, this this time I really jumped in head first into the deep end, and you know, now we've opened an office there. I would encourage anybody who's interested in Brazil to get on a plane, go to Brazil, experience the culture. The country's beautiful. There's an endless array of business opportunities down there, and there will be for the next 10 to 20 years. You know, I won't compare it to China, but I see a lot of the same dynamics that I saw 15 years ago in China that I passed on. So that being said, I would say Brazil's open for business, and you know, if you have an interest, I would really encourage you to pursue it. Thank you.
Q and A now. So if anyone like to make a specific question to Russell, please raise your hand. Yes, please.
Russell, all those financings that you're talking about, they're all in private companies currently?
Right. Yeah, we're predominantly a private equity firm.
Just that, I mean, every situation is different, but is there a methodology to the valuation, or is it just a discounted cash flow for the next 80 years?
You know, the good news is an early stage, and I hate to say this, but cash is king. And, you know, you really want to push the envelope, get aggressive.
So I'm saying, do you start with a multiple of revenues? I mean, what metrics can you use?
I would say all of the above, but there's no set formula. I've been doing this 23 years, and I'll give you an example. I have a biz dev client right now in LA, and you know, their financials are all pro forma, and it's very easy to find market comps, you know, on a company that has revenues. Look, it trades at 6x revenues. They have no revenues. It's all pro forma, and you know, they want a 6 multiple on their pro forma numbers for the next year. And I said, it's not going to happen.
I want head on my head too.
Right. So again, early stage investing, get creative, get aggressive. You know, the capitals have been very impaired, and some of the best deals I've probably done in my lifetime have happened in the last 2 years. So, appreciate it.
Anyone else?